Mami Bamsa Jiva Loke Jiva Buddha Sanat Manasha Shari Yami Brahma Jiva. What?
Parashati.
What does it mean?
Parashati, doesn't that mean troublesome?
Means what?
Troublesome.
Troublesome, yeah. Very good. So, Jiva Soul is part and parcel of Krishna, and right now he's struggling very hard with Manasha Shani.
Isn't that six senses with six senses which include the mind?
That's right. The real scholar. Manasya stani indriyani prakriti stani karshati. So he's struggling very hard with the six senses that include the mind. So that's my nature right now. Struggling very hard from jiva soul, struggling very hard. And that's ontological position. You can use that word if you really want to impress people. And then Krishna's ontological position is what? Can anyone guess?
Enjoyer.
Enjoyer, yeah.
That's good.
Vishnu Tattva. What's the first verse of the Brahma Samhita?
Ishvara.
Krishna. He has no cause, and he's the cause of all causes. So this is Krishna's ontological position. So here we are, in the jiva soul, this part of our soul, Krishna, and we're very tiny, and we're struggling with the success of the mind, and Krishna is not struggling with anything. Because he's the cause of all causes and the supreme controller. And we're not the supreme of anything. We can't control anything. In our minds. So where does Lord Shiva fit in all this? You know, you got Vishnu Tattva. Of course, there's another Tattva too. There's another category, which is called Shakti Tattva. Can anyone think of an example of Shakti Tattva? Right, right. The energy of the Lord. And there's many Lakshmi, expansion of Radharani, and also Durga's expansion, she's Shakti also. So that's another category or ontological position. Because here we're talking about ontology. We're being very scientific here. And so then we ask, where does Lord Shiva fit in that? He's in a special category of his own. And sometimes that's described as Shiva Tattva. Because as the Brahma Samhita tells us, he's an expansion of Krishna. But an expansion of Krishna that deals with the material world, whereas Krishna is Goloka Vina Nivasyati Ati Latin Bhuta. What does that mean?
Goloka
Nivasyati Ati Latin Bhuta.
That he's self-satisfied in his woman himself and is always situated in his abode.
Means he never loses Vrindavan. Goloka Nivasyati. And by his energy, he's expanded everywhere. And that's the miracle of Chinsha Vedavaya Tattva philosophy, which means Krishna's one and different connected and simultaneously, but personally, he never leaves Vrindavan. It's very interesting. But Krishna expands, well, he has his various expansions. We call them the Chaturvyuha expansions. Chaturvyuha means, like in the case of Lord Ramchandra, Ram, Lakshman, Bharata, Chaturvyuha, or Vasudeva's Adrishan, Prajuna, and Aniruddha. And these expansions are called Vishnu Tattva expansions, which are not different from Krishna. There's another verse in the Brahma Samhita. Adwaita Chitta, Nadiya Vananda, Nadiya Purana, Purushana, Nadiya. there's a real one God, one Vishnu Tattva, that's a category, that's an ontological position, and he appears in various places simultaneously doing different things. Because it's the same person, like Ram and Krishna the same. Like someone just wrote me a letter saying, what about someone who chants Ram Ram Hari Hari? Yeah, no, Hari Ram, Hari Ram, Ram Ram Hari Hari, Hari Krishna, Hari Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hari Hari, that's what it's saying. As soon as, when you start in the circle, you know, it actually ends up the same thing. So the Ram in the Hari Krishna mantra can mean Lord Ram, it can mean Balaram. You can also mean Radha Raman. That's interesting. But it refers to the energy of the Lord. She might be Radha Rani, which stands as the other gopis and ultimately the Lakshmis, etc. So Lord Shiva is in a category by himself, sometimes called Shiva Tattva. And the comparison given in the Brahma Samhita is that you have milk, and then the milk is transformed to yogurt. And it doesn't exactly act the same as milk, and you can't take yogurt and add something to it to get milk back. You can get from the air from yogurt. Many people, they make cheese from the air from yogurt. So, but you can't get milk back from it. And you can also get butter from yogurt, too. You can churn the yogurt and actually get butter. And you get butter milk also. So anyway, so Lord Shiva is a very special category by himself. And he deals with the material energy, whereas Krishna never touches the material energy. Even though Krishna is in the heart of everybody, he's not really touching the blood. It's like if you do a heart surgery and you open up your heart, not you, the doctors will do it, then you won't see Krishna there. You just see a lot of blood all over the place. Because of your Hanuman, and if you do heart surgery, you'll see Ram and Sita there. But otherwise, you would just see blood. So Krishna is situated, and Prabhupada describes how the super soul is situated, Krishna is situated. He describes it like reflections on different bodies of water, which is really interesting. The presence is manifest. He's conscious, but he's not in the material world. Because he doesn't touch matter. Whereas Lord Shiva actually touches this matter. And by touching the matter, he actually gives birth to us. Which is interesting. He's like a father. It's like that some of you see the Shiva Ling, which is the Lord Shiva's, represents Lord Shiva's, the male organ of Lord Shiva. Because when Lord Vishnu expands himself as the Mahavishnu, Mahasankarsana, then he glances at the material energy, and that glance is called Shambhu, or Lord Shiva. And so Lord Shiva consorts with this, I mean, has a relationship with Maya, Durga. And as a result, we're planted within this material energy by Lord Shiva. So he's the person who, it's our father, literally. I mean, Krishna's Ambija Pradha. Krishna is the original father of Pradha. But Lord Shiva, in one sense, is the father of all of our bodies. So we worship him. And that's why we worship the Shiva. Along with the yoni, because of the father and mother aspect of that. So that's Lord Shiva's very, very special position. Now, as a expansion of Krishna, or Vishnu, to be precise, he's an expansion of the form of Lord Vishnu known as Sada Shiva. The word Shiva actually means auspicious, and it's the name of Vishnu. As are many of the names of the demigods, in fact, like even the name Indra, although it generally refers to the person, you know, Indra was a real romantic guy in the heavenly planets, it actually means the greatest, you know. And Brahma means the greatest, too. So anyway, Shiva means, she's auspicious, or the most auspicious. And so there's the Sada Shiva, the eternal Shiva in the spiritual world, who's Vishnu Tattva. And that's a category, not Shiva Tattva. And he is the one who expands ultimately through the Mahasankarsana, the what she lived is the greatest Vaishnava. Now, this is a quote from the Bhagavatam. And there's other books too, Vaishnava Adhita. So this quote from the Bhagavatam is Nirmagata, Nirmagana, Yata Ganda Diranam, Vajuta Vita, Vaishnavana Yata Shambhu, Purananam Ida. As the Ganga is the best of all the rivers and Lord Krishna is the best of all lords, so Lord Shiva is the greatest Vaishnava devotee of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. Similarly, Srimad Bhagavatam is the topmost of all Puranas. That's from Bhagavatam 12, chapter 13, chapter 16. Now, why do we say that he's the best of the Vaishnavas? First of all, we have to understand that all of Krishna's expansions all worship Krishna, which is interesting. Whether they're Vishnu Tattva expansions or other expansions like the category of Lord Shiva, your dances are coming soon, or?
Should be.
Should be. Yeah, they'll probably be here about 10 o'clock tonight.
Well, at 13 to 5, they said 36 minutes.
Well, I'm not ending right now, too. I just want to.
Okay.
I just want to prove my point about that being like.
Okay.
Just to say I told you so. So we talk about Lord Shiva being the greatest Vaishnava. Of course, he's Shivatava, a special category. So let us analyze what it means to be the greatest Vaishnava. I mean, some people think to be the greatest Vaishnava means to show the greatest ecstasy or to have the most charisma or to have the most disciples. Yeah, I mean, we have all these like external symptoms or external types of measurements by which we determine whether someone's the greatest. Or the richest man, you know, like Bill Gates, you know, he must be the greatest. Or, of course, he's not the richest man. I think he's richer. So anyway, but really amongst Vaishnavas, what makes someone great is their compassion. As described by Lord Kapiladeva in the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Tatikshiva Kuruni Ka Suridasa Vedena Jata Shatra Shatra Sava Sarvushka. The Vaishnava is known by his qualities that Tatikshiva, first of all, he's tolerant. Kuruni Ka is full of mercy. Because you cannot be full of mercy or merciful without being tolerant. Like Lord Nityananda, who's a dear savior celebrating some time ago. He was so tolerant, he was attacked by Madhai, who caused him to bleed. And then he was begging that Madhai would be forgiven. You know, check out Madhai's story. So that's the Tishra, because it's easy to be Karunika, merciful to someone who's nice to you. You know, someone gives you a big donation or something, you say, oh, blessings. You know, all my blessings. And someone who steals from you, I curse you. So Vaishnava is so merciful. With the hair?
Yeah.
Amazing grace. So Vaishnava is so merciful, whether you steal from him or give him something, he still also arranges for them to take birth in different places. Of course, the Bhagavatam describes that he arranges in interesting ways where people are not following rules and regulations too strictly. I'm not going to get into the details. But he's very compassionate. And because of that, he's very easily pleased. And also easily angry. Because he's dealing, he's not in the mode of ignorance. He's the guna avatar. He's the avatar. The guna avatar means those who control the different gunas. Like Lord Shiva controls the mode of ignorance, Lord Vishnu the mode of goodness, and Lord Brahma the mode of passion. So as the guna avatar of the mode of ignorance, he's not in ignorance, but he's dealing with it all the time. And dealing with living entities who are ignorant. And you see that in many, many cases, those who worship Lord Shiva. And there are many Shiva bhaktas. And ultimately, those Shiva bhaktas become Vishnu bhaktas. Because Lord Shiva advises them. I'm going to read something. I'm going to go longer than I. And this is something I read the other day, actually, on Shiva Ratri, which is Lord Shiva's advice to his wife, as well as his advice to his bhaktas. And this happened on the, I know some of us have happened in Mount Kailash, and the goddess Gauri is actually glorifying Lord Shiva, and she's asking Lord Shiva to cut apart her doubt, and then Lord Shiva begins to glorify her, which is actually the proper thing, and he says, I'm going to tell you something very, very secret. You shouldn't reveal the secret to anyone, but you hear the secret, and this secret will bring the final goal of life. And you'll get material happiness as well as spiritual happiness if you know the secret. This is under sunrise in these verses. And now I'll read some of the verses. He will tell, I will tell you this, O beloved, please listen carefully. Lord Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. His form is spiritual. He is never touched by matter. In order to rescue the people from the ocean of repeated birth and death again and again, he appears in the form of Lord Ranganath and the forms of countless other deities in every corner of the three worlds. The great fools of this world have no devotion for Lord Vishnu. They do not understand he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, always untouched by matter of the Supreme Lord, who is known as Narayana and Hari, who delights his devotees, manifests his form as a cowardful to enjoy the pastimes of the land of Vrindavan. This is from the Psalm of Han Tantra, which is very important Vedic literature. In the discussion between Durga and Lord Shiva. Playing on the flute, he brings great happiness to Shiva. His incarnations, partial incarnations, and the parts of his partial incarnations are all present in the form of a coward boy. That coward boy is Sri Krishna Chandra, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is the son of the coward Ananda. His mother is Yashoda, who is the goddess of Jara, and brings great happiness. O Queen of the Demigods, requested by Brahma, the demigods and his parents, the Supreme Personality of Godhead became the son of Vasudeva. In this way, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the giver of liberation, was born on the earth. He breathed the Vedas into his flute. With his flute, he spoke, in this way, he was born on this earth. I meditate on him, the eternal God of splendor, that is the treasure of the earth. O auspicious one, the person who worships, glorifies, or studies the dark splendor that is Lord Krishna, does not worship, glorify, or study the fair splendor that is Shiva, finds that he lives in hell. O great goddess, a person who thinks Radha and Krishna are different becomes a Brahmin murderer, a wine drinker, a thief of gold, and an outcast who becomes contaminated with all his sins. The splendid Supreme Personality of Godhead is manifested in two forms, he is both Radha and Krishna. O great goddess, in this way the Lord is manifest as a coward boy. When Durvasa Muni was bewildered by the rasa dance in the month of Kartika, Shri Radha asked a question to break his doubt. O Queen of the set the example for all others, as described in the Mahabharata, Mahajanayana, Katasamata. And then Srimad Bhagavatam, the fourth canto, Lord Shiva states that if anyone reads Rudra Gita prayer, he will invoke the mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is Lord Shiva's prayers, the fourth canto. And then in the eighth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Shiva exhibited extreme mercy by drinking the poison that was created from the churning of the milk ocean. We all know that story, the demigods, the demons, they got together to churn the milk ocean. So many things happened, what came out of that milk ocean, like Lakshmi, Kamadenu, Ayurveda, but also what came out, whenever you get something good, you also got to get a bit bad with it. It was a halal of poison that was ready to destroy the whole universe. And the demigods went to Lord Shiva, and what did he do? He drank the poison. And his name as a result was what?
Nilakanta
means blue throat. Because he drank out of compassion. This also shows his great compassionate nature. And he did this to please Lord Vishnu. Then in the Bhagavad Purana, these are different statements by Lord Shiva. Shri Rama Rama Ramiti Rame Rame Mano Rame Sahasra Nama Tat Kal Yam Rama 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 Ne. You don't know. So there he speaks and he tells relishes the chanting of what? Lord Rama's name. Lord Shiva initiated his own life in the chanting of Ram's name. Ram, Ram, such a name. I know we say that at funerals, but Ram's name is the truth. And so it's interesting that Parvati, Lord Shiva's wife, also took initiation of the Hare Krishna mantra from Haridas Thakur. And Lord Shiva's ontological position is also revealed when he confronts the Mohini Murti incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. After Mohini Murti bewildered all the demons and stole the nectar and gave it to the demigods, except for Ketu. And then what happened is that Lord Shiva wanted to see that form. And Lord Vishnu manifested the form of Lord Shiva, he just by Ketu's work, he lost it. He started chasing the Mohini Murti form all over the place being tracked. So that shows that Lord Vishnu's superior position. And these are just different quotes from the Bhagavad Gita. We find when Krishna displays his universal form, Arjuna sees assembled in Krishna's body all the demigods and various living entities, and Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma, and all the sages and divine servants. So within the universal form, Krishna's manifesting Lord Shiva. So you can actually see in this way, there's other proofs that Lord Shiva does come from Vishnu or from Krishna. And we're going to talk about this in a second, the next one actually, of Lord Shiva, sometimes we can go on. And then in the Smriti Shastra, it is said that Lord Shiva constantly chants the what's called the Taraka Brahma Mantra. What is that? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. That stated there, it is through this mantra that Krishna delivers, Lord Shiva delivers the people in Kashi. This is the truth, this is the statement from Smriti Shastra. This is the truth, this is the truth. It is only by chanting this great mantra that Lord Shiva killed Truparasura. So when Lord Shiva was confronting Truparasura, he was chanting Hare Krishna. And here we see one of my favorite forms of Lord Shiva. And this form is called Gopishra Mahadev. So this form is the form of Lord Shiva as a gopi. Because in order to see Krishna's rasa dance in Vrindavan, you have to have a female form. First in the Srimad, it's not in the Srimad, it's actually in the Smriti Shastras. Śrīmad-Kapīśvaraṁ Vande Shankaraṁ Karunāmuhyāṁ Sarvakleśavaraṁ Devaṁ Vrindaranyam Ratipadam. Actually, from the Bhaktivedanta, which is Smriti Shastra. I offer my respectful obeisances to Gopīśvara Mahādeva, who is merciful Lord Shiva himself. He removes all troubles and grants spiritual love in Vrindavan. And not only does Lord Shiva guard Vrindavan as Gopīśvara Mahādeva, but he also guards all the different abodes of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Like you go to Radha Kund, you'll see Kundeshwara Mahādeva. And actually, it's not only Kundeshwara Mahādeva in Radha Kund, there's Lord Shiva guarding all four directions of Radha Kund. And if you go to Kamiran, who's in Kamiran? Think about it. What's Lord Shiva's name?
Kameshwara
Mahādeva, yeah. So wherever you go, where there's Krishna's pastimes taking place, or any of the expansions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, you actually find Lord Shiva there. And there's actually a beautiful verse from the Kalpa-Kalpa-Guruma, Kalpa-Guruma.org. Vrindavani Pate Jaya Soma Soma Pole Sanaka Sanandra Sanatana Naradeya Gopīśvara Vraja Vilasi Yugangri Padme Prema Prihacha Nirupadi Namo Krishna Narayana Vasudeva Ityari Namrita Panamata Bringari Vayakila Dukha Hantre O Shri Ram, O Govinda, O Mukunda, O Shauri, O Shri Krishna O Narayana, O Vasudeva I offer my obeisances unto you, Lord Shiva, the monarch of intoxicated bee-like devotees, maddened by drinking the nectar of bees and other holy names of the Lord. Obeisances unto you, the destroyer of all greed. Actually, when Lord Shiva sings the holy name of the Lord, he becomes so ecstatic that sometimes he thinks that the whole, it seems like the whole universe would be destroyed. Even when he took the Mahaprasadam, just a little speck of Mahaprasadam, the whole universe was actually and he had to be stopped by Durga. And he didn't share any of the Mahaprasadam with Durga. Durga got very upset, worshiped Vishnu and Krishna, and Krishna agreed to give us all Mahaprasadam by her mercy. So text 7. Shri Naradaya isatatam sukobhya yigasita vach yashivara padaya tibnyo arerwati sukhapadaya I offer my respectful obeisances again and again unto you, who is forever inquired, of confidentiality by Sri Narada and other sages, unto you who also grants favors to them very quickly, unto you who bestows the happiness of Kali Bhakti, unto you who creates auspiciousness, and unto you who is the guru of everyone. Chikorini prosava mangataya tatrana kaya sakraya sadasa mukanta mandalaya nana pravenaya osukubhyam. I offer my obeisances unto you who are a festival of auspiciousness for the eyes of Goddess Gauri, unto you who is the monarch of her life breath, unto you who is capable of bestowing transcendental ras, and unto you, who is expert in forever singing songs of the pastimes of Lord Govinda with great longing. And this, of course, is the Shrutipala, which comes at the end. Shrutipala means the fruits of hearing. You know, fruits, Shruti of hearing. So this is a standard in Vaishnava poetry and also in the scriptures like the Bhagavatam, Puranas, and other things. Like anyone hears this chapter, I guess, this particular presentation. Etat Shivas